So in this first unit, we basically have the idea of quark model and standard model, because the main aim of this unit is to see the production and detection of elementary particles. Okay, so if you look into the production and detection, we should know that what are the elementary particles we exactly want to detect. Okay, so for this we are going to study this quark model and standard model, which we already know. Okay, so whatever we have studied in our last sem in particle physics, only a part of it, probably the wake diagram, okay, that is also included in your syllabus, which I'm not going to take now, but it might be a part of your question paper. So we have the quark model, standard model, which you already know, okay, but then apart from that, we are going to see how do we produce and detect the elementary particles. Okay, before that, can anyone tell me how do we produce electrons? We have electron microscopy, right? Scanning electron microscopy, tunneling electron microscopy. The point here is that how we produce electrons. Okay, so we have if you look into a typical XRD machine, it will basically have copper as a source. Okay, X-ray source. Okay, so basically it's copper which is an X-ray source. So similarly in electrons also, when you produce electron, it should have some kind of source. Okay, so what we have is basically we can heat up a metal, apply some kind of energy so that we can extract electrons. But extracting electron is not a difficult job. Okay, but when we talk about elementary particles, where we want to study it in accelerators and CERN and all, I want to produce, let's say, neutrino. Okay, now it becomes more difficult to produce such kind of elementary particles. Okay? So that's where production and detection is slightly complicated than production of electrons and so on. We're going to units and classifications, and then accelerators. We're going to talk about the typical accelerators, like colliding beam accelerators and all. You already have studied about some kind of accelerators. Like, can you give me an example? Any example of accelerators that you've studied? Think about it, okay? Keep thinking. Remember? Cyclotron, right? Okay, cyclotron you already studied. So these are all better modifications of a device which works on similar principles like cyclotrons. Okay, so we have that. Then we have got accelerator complexes, secondary particle accelerators. Okay, interaction of charged particle and radiation with matter. I think already discussed in the first class, but let me tell you again that interaction of any external particles or radiation with matter gives information about that particular particle. Or it also gives out the information about the matter that it is interacting with. Okay, so both ways it works. And detectors of single charge particle, shower detectors and calorimeters. Okay, so but before that, I'll think this is probably a revision. Okay, so just sit back, relax, enjoy the movie, right? It's kind of thing. So it's a simple thing that we have already studied. So I preferred revising it once. Okay, so that we are up to the mark. We did not get the chart, no? Sarvadi,
yeah.
I know. Okay, so we have the elementary particles. We have light particles, intermediate mass particle and heavy particle. That was the first kind of differentiation that we did. Okay, and based on that we have got mesons and leptons, and these are the two we discussed most about. Okay, so leptons basically all have got half spin, so they are basically belonging to the category of fermions, right? And then we have got spin 1, intrinsic spin, so these are all bosons, right? So we have that. Then we have got mesons, we have got eta, pions and kaons, okay? And we have got different elementary particles, okay? Let's not take too much time for this, because this you have already known, and this table obviously I have never asked you in this exam. But this is something which is more important, because this is our standard model, right? So the other session we did, we did it on the board, but this time we have it here. You can take the reference of that, but this is also there in your syllabus, okay? Let me just make a smooth transition from nuclear physics to particle physics. So let's take the important points here. So we basically have got six quarks, okay? So what are the six quarks? Up, down, charm, strange, top, bottom. All of them at some point of time has been detected by some detector or the other, right? Just like the CFD has detected, I told you the other day, the top quark, right? I think it was in 94, I guess, okay? So it was detected at that time. So similarly, other particle accelerators have also detected different quarks. Then we have got the six leptons, okay? These leptons plays a very critical role. So we know that the electrons, muons and tauons are the leptons, okay? and they also have it attached with them is muon neutrino, tau neutrino, and electron neutrino. Okay, and one of the mistakes that many of you did in your final exam is that I told you that each of them has got a quantum number attached to them. So if I am saying electron, it has got a electron neutrino quantum number. Okay, so all of these quantum numbers are kind of different. Okay, so when you look into that conservation law which I told you, okay, so please revisit that problem because that is also a part of your NET syllabus. Okay, important. Next, four gauge bosons. I'll come to the term why we actually call them gauge bosons, and this one is called as scalar bosons. Okay, so these gauge bosons are basically vector bosons. Okay, these are vector bosons. Okay, called vector bosons, and we have them as gluons, photons, Z bosons and W bosons. Okay. Again, I like to tell you that the mass, even if you don't remember it, it's still fine. Okay. But please try to remember the charge and the spin. Charge and the spin. Okay. So charge and spin are important. Okay. I've given another table here, so I hope you can remember it more easily. Some of you, when you explained the standard model in your exam, you messed up here. Okay. I think the charge you have written for Z boson and W boson just the other way, plus minus 1 and 0, if I am not wrong, some of you have written it, okay, because of which you have lost some marks, okay. Okay, next, we have got one scalar boson. So Higgs boson, as all of us know, that has been detected in the year 2012, okay, so this is the latest in the picture. But this standard model is never complete, okay, it's not complete, it's not a total validation in itself, okay. So there are a lot of drawbacks of the standard model which we did not discuss. So this time we are also going to discuss what is the drawback of the standard model. Okay. So top quark, not 94, it's 95. Okay. Tau neutrino 2000, Higgs boson 2012. So what does it tell us? That this is not the monotonous research that many of us are doing in nanomaterials, taking metal oxide which has been worked for the last 40, 50 years. Okay. People are still working on these things. Okay, 2012 is very recent, so there are a lot of better scopes in particle physics. Okay, so please note this: three generations of matter, okay, and then interaction and force carriers. Okay, so we know that graviton has not been included there. Okay, so with this sem we are going to understand that why graviton is not included and what is the story behind it. Okay, so before we proceed, let us talk a bit about gauge bosons. Okay, so as I told you in the previous picture that these are all force carriers, even Higgs boson also. Okay, what is Higgs boson responsible for in general? Mass, right? If you remember the other day I told you, whatever mass you possess is basically credited to Higgs boson. Okay, and that was predicted in the 1980s. Okay, so let's talk about this. So gauge boson is basically a force carrier. It's basically a boson, so obviously the spin is intrinsic. Okay, and it carries any fundamental interaction of nature, commonly called forces. So all the three that are listed there are all fundamental in nature. Okay, gravitation is not included, but gauge bosons have a spin one, and that's why they are called vector bosons. Okay, so it has got spin 1, and that is why it is called vector bosons. Okay, now gauge bosons, they are different from other kind of bosons, you have to understand that, and that is why they are not included below the Higgs, below the Higgs boson is not included below this, it's on a different color scheme altogether. Okay, so you see this is different. The fundamental scalar boson is nothing but the Higgs boson. The Higgs boson is the fundamental scalar boson. Okay, and meson, what are mesons actually? Mesons are a composition of quarks, if you remember. Okay, so if you go to mesons here, what do you see? This nucleons, right? This is nothing but quarks, combination of quarks, right? There are many mesons which are basically combination of quarks. So if they are combination of quarks, that means that they are composite bosons. Okay, because quarks are there and they are interacting with each other, and that is because of this exchange of this fundamental interaction particles. Okay, so you have to remember that part, that mesons are composite bosons and are made up of quarks. Okay, so in your exam, if I ask you a question, I might ask you, give a brief idea about gauge bosons, then you have to write down, make some sentences, because here I have preferred writing it point wise, okay, so that it's easy to remember. But please, I'm trusting your English framing skills, okay. I'm not giving you sentences for that. Books I have already suggested last time, okay. So this is taken from that particular book. I'll share the book also. So what were photons? Remember, right? So this is all a revision, okay. Electromagnetic interaction. What are W and Z bosons? Weak interaction. And what are gluons? Strong interaction. Okay. So we have got these three fundamental particles, okay. And eventually they are massless, right? Massless, okay. So what is the drawback of the standard model? This is something which we did not discuss. Okay? We are going to discuss today. What are the shortcomings of the standard model? Okay. So this standard model does not explain some of the phenomenons. Okay. One of them is, we know it's gravitons. Okay. It's not included there because it's not detected as yet. Okay. So this in general we can say this is not a complete theory. Okay. This is not a complete theory in itself. This is not a complete theory of fundamental interaction, and it does not, okay, please note, does not fully explain baryon asymmetry. Now something you might be excited about is the last unit is introductory cosmology. That is what we are going to study. In introductory cosmology, I have also included a part on baryon symmetry asymmetry. So there we are going to see that this model does not explain this baryon asymmetry. Okay, so there is a balance which is not maintained in case of baryon. Okay. Incorporates full theory of gravitation. So it does not incorporate the full theory of gravitation. Not that. It does not account for the accelerating expansion of the universe as possibly described by dark energy. In short, it means this model does not talk about dark energy. Nothing about dark energy. Okay. So you don't know about it. Does not contain any viable information on dark matter as well. Okay, so please understand, dark energy and dark matter are two different aspects of the universe. Okay, you need to see those things. It does not incorporate neutrino oscillation and their non-zero masses. So the experimental setup T2K that we have in Japan, there when we are talking about neutrino oscillation, that actually is not included in the standard model. Okay. And that's why probably the standard model is not a full theory in itself. Okay? Quark model in many ways is much better. Okay? Quark model also we have studied. You remember the weight diagram that we have done? That's a part of quark model. Okay? Okay. So let's just look into this, some simple points. So elementary particles, we have got the fermions and we have got the bosons, right? And we have got the half integer spin here. We have got the integer spin here. Okay. This obeys Bose-Einstein statistics, this obeys Fermi-Dirac statistics. But I'd like to ask you, you have done your statistical mechanics course, right? Have you studied about Fermi-Dirac and Bose-Einstein statistics there? You have derived the relations, right? So all of them comes into this picture. So you see, quantum mechanics, you have studied, it's here. Theory of relativity, you have studied, it's here. Okay? Statistical mechanics, you have studied, it's included here. Okay? So these things are actually a part of this. So nuclear physics or particle physics includes a lot of other topics. Okay, so we should have the basic idea about these things. So we've got the quarks and the antiquarks, which comes under fermions. We have got the leptons and the antileptons, which comes under fermions. Okay, and quarks basically will have a spin half. Okay, and it will have something which is called the color charge. Color charge. Okay, and from this term of color charge comes the topic quantum chromodynamics. Okay. So we are also going to study about quantum chromodynamics. It doesn't mean that they actually possess a color. It's basically called something which we call as flavor. It is a way of representing. Okay. What are the fundamental colors that we have? RGB, right? Red, green and blue, right? We combine them, you basically get the white color. Okay. So if you say you are getting something as white, means you are getting something as neutral. Okay. So in that way, those ideas are used in quantum chromodynamics. So we are going to see that. Then there is no color charge obviously in leptons and antileptons. Okay. Then participate in strong interaction. Now this is very important from any point of view, exam point of view, entrance point of view, NAT, gate, whatever. So these quarks and antiquarks will participate in strong interaction, but leptons and antileptons will participate in electroweak interaction. They are mostly seen in electroweak interaction. Okay. Electroweak interaction is something which is very much established. combining electromagnetic interaction and weak interaction. So generations, we have got the up, down, these are also called flavors, okay. So in some book, if they mention flavors, don't get confused. It's the same thing as up, down, charm, stain, top, bottom. In generation of leptons, we have got electron, electron, neutrino, muon, muon, neutrino, tau, tau, neutrino. So this entire thing is basically nothing but the standard model. Right? Standard model. Now look into this, gauge bosons. We have got photon, W and Z boson, 8 type of gluon, graviton. Okay? Apart from graviton, everything else is included in the standard model. Higgs boson is included in the standard model. So this entire thing is nothing but the standard model, which is the part of elementary particle. So when you study this, I prefer you make this table in your copy and try to remember this as much as possible, okay? Trick question, descriptive, objective, any questions might be from here. So what is anti-electron? We lovingly call it positron, right? Right? The positron is something which is very much popular because we are also going to study phenomena like annihilation. So that's why we must know about positron. We have got hypothetical graviton. So if you mention here a spin 1, I think this is not correct for this, okay? This source is Wikipedia. So this is not correct because graviton has a spin 2, okay? And it's basically a tensor boson. So when you consider something as a vector, tensor, okay? If you consider a tensor, you are representing that in the form of a matrix, if you remember, okay? So matrix and so these things are there. Okay? Anyway, not going into that detail there. So as I told you, flavors, okay? So please remember the term particle, leptons and quarks. And if you talk about flavor, that means these leptons have flavor, these six, okay? And quarks has got these six flavors. So this is just a term, okay? Nothing to get too confused for, okay? Please remember the term flavor. Okay, now the question is why strange? I guess I have already explained this. Depends on the decay time, okay? That's why we call it strange particle. But this time, if I ask you a question that why these strange particles are called strange, okay, the answer should be something in these lines, okay? So let's just read through. So their behavior was strange in the sense that they were produced prolifically in strong interaction. So these strange particles were produced in strong interactions. Can you give me an example of a strange particle? Any example? Kaons, right? Kaons, right? K plus, K zero, K minus, these are all strange particles, okay? So they are produced in strong interaction and therefore it was expected that they will decay also in strong interaction, right? It was expected at that time. That means the time scale should be around 10 to the power minus 23 seconds. So the time scale or the decay is quite fast in strong interaction, okay? But what happened? They decayed extremely slowly by weak interaction. So that behavior was quite strange, okay, and hence they were called as strange particles, okay. So what was expected was that they will decay in strong interaction, but they decayed in weak interaction, okay. Let's try to remember this point so that you can write down this in your exams, okay. Two more questions. The solution to this puzzle was that, now initially people didn't knew it was strange particle, but initially people just saw that there was a particle which actually was produced in a strong interaction, but decayed in a weak interaction. So people didn't know anything about strangeness at that time. So what was the solution? The solution was that these particles carried a new quantum number S. Whenever we are talking about production of particle, decaying of particle, we are dealing with an equation where we have to equate both sides. And we are looking into the conservation of quantum numbers. Baryon quantum number, okay? And so strangeness, charm, stain, everything is there, right? And we are also talking about conservation in energy, conservation in momentum, conservation in mass and so on. Okay? So we have that. So the quantum number was not introduced, but at that time when they introduced the quantum number S, the strangeness, it basically was seen that it was conserved in strong interaction, okay? And one, it was seen that when we're talking about strong interaction, they were produced in pairs. They were produced in pairs. That means I will have S is equal to plus 1 and S is equal to minus 1. But when they decayed singly and weakly. So they decayed individually. But when they are produced in pairs. You getting the logic, right? So the behavior was strange, okay? So they decayed individually and then we had this, what you remember this? Delta S is equal to plus minus 1. What do we call this usually? The selection rule, right? The selection rule into non-strange particles. So they will decay weakly, they will follow this selection rule and they will decay into non-strange particles, okay? So if the question is why strange, if you write down only this, one mark, okay, सो लेट मी मार्क दिस, दिस इज वन. ओके, अगर इसको डाला तो वन वन, सो वन प्लस वन टू होता है. ठीक है, सो एग्जाम में छोटा मत लिखना. हाँ, इट विल कम फॉर टू मार्क्स. चलो दे दिए मिड सेम में, ठीक है, पढ़ लेंगे इसको, बट ट्राई टू अंडरस्टैंड इट. ओके, सिंस आई एम पुटिंग इट ऑन यूट्यूब आई कैन नॉट से द क्वेश्चन इज लीक्ड. ओके, सो नॉट लीक्ड. Okay, so let's just note down some finer points. Okay, see, the best thing about doing a PowerPoint presentation is I can give more information, because what I have is more time. On a board, I have to look into the watch and do it. Okay, carry load time. Okay? Let me tell you one more thing. When you look into the projector and this is your first class or the first half of the class, you feel very sleepy, just like Anuradha is feeling right now. Okay, sona mat, theek hai, jaga, thoda aur jagcha ho jayega. इंटरेस्ट तो चलेगा. ठीक है, नो वट एवर यू आर फीलिंग, आई फील द सेम व्हेन आई यूज्ड टू हैव माय क्लासेस ऑन प्रोजेक्टर. ठीक है, आज सुनिंग होता ना. ओके, थैंक यू फॉर कमिंग. अच्छा लग रहा है, फुल स्ट्रेंथ क्लास देखते हैं माइनस वन. ओके, सो द कॉमन मटेरियल ऑफ द यूनिवर्स आर स्टेबल पार्टिकल्स. प्लीज रिमेंबर दिस, दैट वट एवर वी आर सीइंग अराउंड अस इज मोर और लेस स्टेबल इन नेचर. इफ इट वॉज अनस्टेबल वी वुड नॉट हैव एग्जिस्टेड. इफ एटम वॉज अनस्टेबल वी वुड नॉट हैव एग्जिस्टेड. So everything is stable, right? So mostly it was seen that these stable particles are nothing but the electrons or the up and the down quarks. You can analyze everything around you. You will see it's mostly made up of electrons or up and down quarks. So what does it mean? That the other quark doesn't exist? No, that's wrong. That exists, but they are not stable in nature. So if you consider strain, charm, bottom, top, they are not stable in nature, and that is why it is also difficult to detect sometimes. Okay. If something doesn't stay in its place, how am I supposed to detect it, right? So the thing is, it has to be stable. So the heavier quarks, charm, strange, bottom, top, combine to form heavier than the proton and the neutron. They are heavier in weight, okay? But they are not stable. These are unstable. So the main point is, these are unstable, okay? And they decay rapidly, very fast. So if they decay within a time range of 10 to the power minus 13 second, basically their detection becomes very easy, difficult. Okay, so what do you mean by unstable, by the way? Unstable means it exists, but it decays into something else. Okay, in a very short span of time. Okay, so I cannot have it individually. Okay, so it's difficult. So it will basically decay, and it will decay to up and down combination. So if it decays to up down combination, it's up and down. Okay. So it originated might be from a strange particle, but it finally gets and decays into an up down. It is something like nuclear materials, like uranium, right? When it starts decaying, it finally gets stable at lead, right? It becomes lead and basically gets stable, okay? Something like that. So this is only in very high energy collision at man-made accelerators or naturally in cosmic rays that heavy or unstable varieties are observed. So the question is, where do we observe it? How do we find it? Okay, in man-made system we have got those accelerators where you can observe it, and naturally you can see it in cosmic rays, right? Cosmic showers and all, I think you have heard about it. Okay, cosmic rays and all these were interesting. Okay, but anyway, we did not do much about these things before. So let's go into some more finer details of interaction. Okay, so strong interactions. So the strong interaction will bind the quark in the neutron and the proton. Okay, I think these things we have discussed briefly but not in detail. Okay, so we have the quarks in the neutron and the protons, and they are bound together by something which we call as the strong interactions. Okay, so this is responsible for the stability of the nuclei, we can say. Okay, important. The inter quark force is mediated by a mass particle called the gluon. Okay. So if you remember the other class, last session, I told you about this unknown force that exists. Okay, suppose you are playing a volleyball or you are playing badminton. Okay, you know that you are not supposed to go on the other side of the net, because that's against the law, right? And if you are not forced by someone, you are definitely going to go for the shuttle and you are going to return it back, right? So there is some kind of unknown force that is acting. And what is that force because of the shuttlecock? It's moving here, you are going there. It's going here, you are going here, right? So that's basically a kind of unknown force that is acting, okay? So here also, there should be some kind of unknown exchange of forces, and that is nothing but gluon, okay? Now, one more important thing to understand here is that gluon, if it has mass, then this up quark, down quark or even proton and neutron in general should continuously have different masses, should keep on changing the masses again and again, okay? But that is actually not detected. But does that happen? There are a lot of questions on that also, okay? So please remember that whatever scientific idea we have, okay, there are more into it, okay? So everything is not complete in itself, okay? Next, electromagnetic interaction. So it is responsible for virtually all the phenomenon in extra nuclear physics. So this term extra nuclear physics, we can say nothing but we are talking about particle physics. The bound states of electrons within nuclei, that is atoms and molecules. So atoms and nuclei are, or molecules are bound together because of electromagnetic interaction. Is it logical? Yes. Proton hai, nuclei hai, positive hai, electron is there, it's revolving around the nucleus. There is some kind of interaction between the electron and the nuclei, right? Since protons is charged, it's positive, and the electrons are charged negative, so basically there is some kind of exchange of force, and that is nothing but the electromagnetic interaction. So whenever we are talking about electromagnetic interaction, please remember this is actually for the charged particles that we have, okay? Might be elementary particles, might be a bigger picture like a neutron or proton, okay? Might be only quarks and so on. For the intermolecular forces in liquids and solids, so even the intermolecular forces that exist between liquid and solid is credited to electromagnetic interaction. Okay? So these interactions are mediated by photon exchange. Right? Photon. So let's not get confused, because sometimes even they ask you questions about what are photons, okay? What are phonons? Okay? You have to remember these terms, okay? Weak interactions. Okay? So weak interaction is basically a slow process, okay? That's what we have seen in strange particle, because strange particle decays by weak interaction, and weak interaction is a slow process. So everything is connected, okay? And when we consider about beta decay, you remember beta plus and beta minus decay, right? So these are all nothing but the slow processes of nuclear beta decay. So that's weak interaction. So the emission of a radioactive nuclei of an electron and neutrino. You remember with electron we have a neutrino emission, right? So that's the weak beta decay. So the mediators of the weak interactions are W bosons or Z bosons. Okay, they are masses of the order of 100 times of proton mass. So look into this. What is the mass of proton? Order? What is the mass of proton? 10 to the power minus 27. So 4 times heavier than 10 to the power 4 times heavier than electron, right? So that's proton, and this is 100 times what of the proton mass, 100 times the proton mass. That means it definitely has got some kind of mass, okay, and there should be definitely some kind of effect that is involved. So if there is an exchange in case of weak interaction and they have masses, that means the particle between which it is getting exchanged, their mass should continuously fluctuate. Common sense, right? Kuch mass nikal ke yahan ja raha hai, kuch mass nikal ke yahan ja raha hai, the mass should fluctuate. Right? So that is also an interesting part of these things. Okay? So they are not massless. Previously when they were not discovered, people thought that they were massless, because the interaction was studied and the masses of the individual particles were measured, their variation was not much because it was not detected. Different case. Then gravitational interaction acts between all types of particles. Now the beauty of gravitation, I'll tell you the story of sun. Okay? How did the sun actually begin? It was actually a condensed system, right? It was a condensed system. How did it have so much of enormous force to condense it? It was because of gravitation. Okay, and then it, you can say, kind of exploded. Okay, and then we started with the radiations coming out. Then we had the neutrino, and we have the muon, gluon, and so on. Everything was coming out of it, right? So that means the interaction was changing, right? So we had this weak interaction, strong interaction there, but it originated from gravitation, right? So if it originated from gravitation and later on it had weak interaction and strong interaction, that means gravitation must be a part of this model. Gravitation must be a part of this model, but we are not able to do it now. Okay, not able to incorporate gravitation into the model, right? So that is why it is interesting that we cannot ignore gravitation. Okay, we have that story later in the slides. So acts between all type of particle, gravitation. Gravity is by far the weakest. How much, what is the order of the weakness of gravitation compared to nuclear? Nuclear, if it's 1, gravitation is 10 to the power minus You remember? I have it in the slide, okay? 10 to the power minus 37, right? At 37, 38, something like that, okay? We have it. So you can see so much weak, okay? If nuclear is 1, gravitation is 10 to the power minus 37 weaker. It's dominant on the scale of the universe. So if you consider the universe, okay, it's dominant on that scale, okay? It is supposedly mediated by exchange of a spin to boson, the graviton, which is yet to be that in the standard model. So if you look into this, this basically talks about connecting the interactions, okay? So think about the sun, okay? Source of every energy, all happiness, okay? So the sun is very happy here.
The sun is
Asian.
The sun looks Asian.
Asian dikh raha hai kya? Haan, matlab main thoda racist hoon. You want to be Asian, okay? You can be racist in terms of Asian and Europeans, okay? हम एशियन है, वी आर प्राउड टू बी एशियंस. यहाँ कोई नहीं है ना बाहर के, लाइक इन अगर इट डजंट हैव, इट हैज, राइट? सॉरी, आई एम पुटिंग इट ऑन यूट्यूब, शुड नॉट रिकॉर्ड दिस. ओके, सो लेट्स लुक इनटू दिस. ओके, सो वी हैव द सन, अ हैप्पी सन, एंड बेसिकली इट स्टार्टेड सम ट्रिलियंस एंड ट्रिलियंस ऑफ इयर्स बैक. ओके, एंड वी हैव गॉट सेपरेट अनरिलेटेड इंटरेक्शंस आर नॉट एक्सेप्टेबल सिंस आइंस्टाइन डेज. सो पीपल न्यू दैट इट वॉज नॉट एक्सेप्टेबल, but then how to make it together became a problem. Okay, so it basically strived for a unified field, and based on this we had got grand unified theory, and then electro weak interaction where two interactions were unified. Then came up the string theory. Okay, many people challenges the string theory. Okay, so you can listen to different kind of lectures on these things. So in the 1970s these weak and strong interactions were unified, okay, and as per experiment have the same strength at higher energy. So even if you consider a higher energy system, this the strength does not get lesser, okay, does not mitigate. So we have lower energy, the symmetry is broken. But what happens when we consider a lower energy, the symmetry breaks. So again there were issues with that, okay. But if you go into the story, the first thing is everything was condensed under gravity until thermonuclear fusion began. What is the source of sun's energy? Fusion, right? So at some point the fusion had to start, right? Two hydrogen had to combine to give you helium and so on, and then the reaction will go on, we'll get beryllium and all those things, okay? The chain, you remember P2, P3, the chains, okay? So these things has to start somewhere, okay? At the beginning of time, let's say. But they had to be condensed under gravity at that time. So that was the gravity part included. Then what happened? The first stage where we talk about proton-proton getting combined, and we are getting a deuteron and a positron and a neutrino, it was a part of weak interaction. We know now that it's weak interaction. And that was the first stage that happens in the production of energy in sun, right? Then what happened? The neutrinos got detected and posed more questions. You remember? What was the most important question for neutrino detection? The question of? Missing energy, right? The missing energy. You remember that graph, right? We have a graph, okay? I'll improve my skills on drawing here, don't worry. You remember this graph, I guess. Right? Achha bana hai na? Okay. So this part is the missing energy. This part is the missing energy, right? If it was constant, then why don't we have the energy here? Right? So this was the missing energy part. So that was about the question of neutrino. Next stages involve strong interaction. So if you look into the other reactions which are involved, there is a lot of reaction which deals with strong interaction. Done. Then we have got the energy liberated. Now that energy had to be transferred from the inner core to the outer core of the sun so that it's radiated. And as we know that the sun is a source of all kind of electromagnetic radiation. If it's a source of electromagnetic radiation, that means there should be electromagnetic interaction. So we have gravity, weak interaction, strong interaction, electromagnetic interaction. Everything started from the evolution of sun. Okay, that means whatever we are studying is not complete in itself. Okay, abhi tak nature ke paas bahut kuch hai jo hame nahi pata, right? So all forces plays a vital role in stellar evolution. So whatever we consider is a stellar explosion, origin of star, okay, and all those things, supernova and all, okay, everything. Everywhere, whatever we are talking about, all these interactions are involved. Okay? The only thing is we are not able to detect some of the things. Okay? We are not able to decipher all the mysteries. Okay? So strong interaction, nuclear interaction, one. Electromagnetic, it's 10 to the power minus 2, the next strongest. And electroweak, 10 to the power minus 7. And gravity is 10 to the power minus 39. Okay, minus 37 is also there in some books. Okay. So this is the, on a scale we can say. Okay. So mean lifetime decay through a weak interaction is 10 to the power minus 10 seconds. Okay, 10 to the power minus 10 seconds. Now for a strong interaction, this is 10 to the power minus 23 seconds. Now this strong interaction, this cannot be measured directly. This can be. Okay, there are devices to measure this directly because this is measurable. But for strong interaction, it cannot be measured directly. And that's why we are using some indirect ways to measure these time scales. Okay, so we also use the uncertainty principle here. Now what does the uncertainty principle talk about? Mostly we talk about the momentum and the position, right? But we have the other canonical conjugate components. We basically call it the energy, okay? Energy and time. So if you look about the uncertainty principle and I want to relate with these theory, we have to talk about relates the lifetime and the uncertainty in energy of a state. So if you are able to detect the time, certainly we won't be able to detect the energy and vice versa, right? So we basically call an unstable particle, that's the heavier quarks, okay, do not have a unique mass, but a distribution width. So that means the mass is not unique, because there is constant exchange of forces, right? So the mass is not unique, there is a distribution of that mass, okay? And that mass distribution is somewhere related with the uncertainty principle and this particular relation, okay? So this distribution width of mass, where mass and energy are more or less related because E is equal to mc square. So whenever I am talking about a distribution width related with mass, I am also talking about energy. Am I talking about energy? Because E is equal to mc square, right? And I am talking about lifetime here, which is tau here, so which is the time, okay? So this is the uncertainty we are talking about. So the uncertainty in terms of tau, which is a mass dependent quantity, okay, this is a mass dependent quantity, okay, m nu, okay, mass dependent quantity, and this tau is time. So do the cross multiplication, tau into t is nothing but h cross, that's the uncertainty, right? So when tau is very short, okay, its value can be inferred from the measured width of tau mass, okay? So if that lifetime is very small, okay, the mass becomes more or less uncertain in nature. If the mass is small, the time becomes uncertain in nature, and so on, because they are inversely proportional, right? So that's something which is related with uncertainty principle. So we cannot escape the basic physics in order to understand standard model of whatever higher order physics we are going to understand, okay? So I'm not going to start with quark model today, okay? But if you remember this picture, you remember this picture? Why did I show you this picture? No, this is not the weight model. Weight model, if you remember, it's a triangle and all, okay? Hexagon is also there, but hexagon I have not defined. The weight model, I have talked about up, down and strange quarks, okay? And anti-up, anti-down, anti-strange and so on. This model, I have told you to remember the strangeness, okay? Charge, okay? You take the hexagonal line and all those lines, okay? This is basically nothing but the quark model, okay? So in our next class, we are going to start with the quark model.